So the final core area of the EarSketch API that I want to look at in this module is effects. And so in this video, we're going to look at the set effect function, and we're going to look at a number of different ways to use it to add effects to tracks, to set the values of effect parameters, and also to create effects envelopes that gradually change those effects parameter values over time. And so I want to start with the simplest things that we can do with set effect. Set effect is a function, is a kind of unusual function. You can define functions in Python that can have different numbers of arguments depending on what you want to do with them. So set effect can have two arguments, like in the example we see here, but it can also have as many as six. So we're going to start with a simple two-argument version and kind of build our way up to more complex operations. So what we see in this simple incarnation is that there's just two arguments. First is the track we want to add the effect to, and then the second one is the name of the effect. And all the effects in EarSketch are referenced by constants. So like distortion is the constant for distortion. Here's a list of them, just so you can see them on a slide. But we've also included documentation on the course website that has all kinds of information about all of these effects and what they are and what they can do and how to use them. As you look through this list, you'll see that there's several that you're probably familiar with from things that we did in module two of the course, things like dynamic range compression and delay and distortion and panning. And volume. And there might be some others here that you haven't used before, but are easy to experiment with and play around with and kind of see what they can do. So let's go ahead and do this and just add an effect to a track in EarSketch. So I have a simple example here where I've just taken a piano sound from the Richard Devine library, and I've added it to a track with no effects at this point. So I can run that script, and we can listen to the dry sound with no effects on it. So now I want to add an effect. So all I have to do is type in set effect, the track I want to put it on, one, and the effect I want to add, distortion. And I can run that script again, and you'll see immediately we have an effects lane here that's showing that distortion exists on this track. And right now it's just at a constant value. It's at the default value because I haven't configured anything else. And we're going to hear a lot of kind of nasty distortion on this piano when I play this back. A couple other things are just available to you, of course. I can hit the bypass button if I want to listen to this without the effect. And then also, if my effects lanes are starting to take up too much space in my DAW and I just want to hide them temporarily, I can hit this effects button up here. That'll hide them. If I hit it again, it shows them again. One other thing that's important is there's a special constant in EarSketch to put effects on the master track. So in Reaper, we could add effects to the master track, and that would apply the effect to all the tracks in our project. We can do a similar thing in EarSketch, and the constant is very simple. It's just master underscore track in all caps. So if I want to do that, all I have to do is instead of putting in a track number, I just put in master underscore track. Now this is going to sound exactly the same right now, of course, because I only have one track. But when you look at it in the workstation, it actually looks different because you can see that our effects lane now is part of our master track as opposed to being part of track one. So that's another technique that's available to you. For now, I'll switch this back to track one. So that's the most basic way to add an effect, which is all of its default parameters to a track or the master track in EarSketch. As you listen to that, I don't know if you were thinking the same thing as me, but I thought that was a lot of distortion for piano. It was pretty nasty. So what if I want to reduce the amount of distortion? Well, then I can set a parameter value. And this is akin to what we did in Reaper when we opened up the effects dialog box and there were a bunch of sliders and we could change the values of those sliders to set them to new values for that effect to configure it. And that those would stay fixed for the entire piece of music, but we could set them to whatever we wanted. And so if we're going to do that, we add two additional arguments to our set effect call. We start again with the track that we want to apply this to and the effect constant that we want to use. But then we give it a parameter constant, which represents the parameter, the slider essentially, that we want to change and the value that we want to take that on. And again, if you look at the supplementary effects documentation, it lists for every effect, it explains what all the different parameter constants are and what their values can be. So for instance, for pitch shift, our parameter is pitch shift shift, or at least one of our parameters available to us is pitch shift shift. How much do we want to shift the pitch by? And then we specify that in semitones. So negative two here means down two semitones or a whole step. So I can go in and I can do this in our script. I'll start with distortion here. So the parameter I actually want to use for that is disto underscore gain. And then the amount of distortion, let's say that I want to make it less, I'll make it just 5. And we can see how that sounds. And come back here to our workstation view. And you can see that that bar is a lot lower than it was when we did it with the default value. Maybe that's too low. Maybe I want to increase it to 10. So I can do that as well. Run that again. You can see it's a little higher now. So now I want to stack another effect on here. I want to do pitch shift. So I'll add pitch shift. And the parameter I want to change is pitch shift underscore shift. And yeah, we'll take this down by a whole step, negative two semitones. Run that again, and you should hear that it's a different pitch than it was before. But first I want to go back and talk about this notion of effects envelopes. So we spent a lot of time on effects envelopes in module 2 of the course, where we were looking at ways that you could essentially define, by clicking different points in the effects lanes, you could control automations for changes to these parameters over time. And it was typically done in the form of drawing dots. And so you were defining essentially a starting time and value and an ending time and value. And then you could do this again with another starting point and ending point from there. And you can define as many of these as you want on a track to start doing very complex curves if you want. So each of these ramps, you know, from a starting point and value to an ending point and value, is defined by a single call to setEffect. So if I want to do these more complicated ramps, I just call setEffect a bunch of times. And so it starts off the same way with the track and the effect name and the parameter name. And then I just give it the values for these two points. What is my starting value? What is the starting time? What is the ending value? And what is the ending time? So as an example, if I wanted to do a glissando with my pitch shift to have it change gradually over time, I can say, well, I want it to start at negative two semitones in measure one and then go up to zero semitones, to the original pitch, by the time we get to measure five. So let's go ahead and do some of this in our code. I'll do that with our pitch shift. So I'll type in exactly that, negative two semitones at measure one, going up to the original pitch at measure five. And go ahead and run that. And then when we come in here, you should be able to see the change. It's a very subtle change there. So maybe I'll do something more dramatic so we can see more of a dramatic curve here. So I'll start at an octave lower, just so you can see the curve going up very clearly. And I can play that and you'll hear the pitch shift. So you could also hear that very clearly, I'm sure. Now, what about our distortion? Maybe I want to start with 10 at measure one, but by the time we get to measure three, I want it to go down to zero. And then maybe I want to do another ramp with my distortion between measures three and five. So I'm specifying again the track one, the effect distortion, the parameter disto gain. Oops, I spelled that as grain by mistake, so gain. And so I want to start at zero, no distortion, measure three, but maybe go up to tons of distortion, say 20, by the time we get to measure five. So I can run that script, and then you can see here, we have a more complex curve where it's coming down, and then it's going back up. So we can go ahead and listen to this. So I'm sure you agree that I totally butchered this sound, but it was for the point of showing these dramatic curves and these envelopes that we could draw in the effects lanes through multiple calls to set effect. So at this point, I want to recap all the things that we've done in module 4 as we've introduced Python and the EarSketch API. We've looked at the concepts of algorithmic composition, and we looked at it specifically in terms of EarSketch and Python. And then we covered some basic concepts in Python, looking at variables, functions, constants, strings, loops, and lists. And we've covered basic ideas in the EarSketch API, functions to place audio on our multi-track dot timeline, to do pattern sequencing by defining our own rhythms with beat strings, and adding effects, controlling effects parameters and envelopes to change those effects parameters over time. In module 5 of the course, we're going to kind of take everything that we've learned here and go a step further, really looking at the notion of not just writing sequential instructions for a computer to follow, but at writing musical algorithms that take fundamentally different approaches through code of how we make music.